something's out there for 20 years and hasn't really taken the market, I think there is something that's not beneficial to us. A few words on nucleoplasty. I'm not going to bore you with all the studies out there that are in the literature for those mechanical lumbar disc decompressions and the different techniques. It seems to be that they have some efficacy for the treatment of leg pain. There's no evidence whatsoever for managing low back pain with those techniques, even though it's used quite a bit for this. And so there are no RCTs for any of these techniques, and the level of evidence that it is successful is at about level 3. The same is true for the percutaneous lumbar laser disc decompression, that there is some efficacy for leg pain, no RCTs, low level of evidence that it is helpful. Coming to stenosis, we all know that traditionally the mechanism do not have the result that we would like to have, about a success rate of 60%, which is less than what we would expect. There are many uncontrolled studies out there coming to a success rate of 85% for the less invasive techniques, the laminotomy techniques, and the level of evidence that they may be more successful is also low, level 3. There are some controlled studies that show equivalent results for laminotomies comparing to laminectomies. Some studies show superior results for the less invasive techniques. So the level of evidence is a little higher for these techniques. And there are some biomechanical studies showing clearly that the bilateral laminotomy is non-destabilizing in contrast to the laminectomy approach. And a study we did in a randomized controlled trial years back, we have a 10-year follow-up right now, shows that actually the less invasive approach, the bilateral laminotomy technique, showed superior results. So this would be a level of evidence 1 to 2. What about endoscopy for the spinal stenosis? The technique is the same as the unilateral laminotomy approach. You use the endoscope, and this has been done early on in the around 2000. Most of these studies have started. And what's interesting to see that we do have good and excellent results also in the endoscopic group, but we have significantly more complications, particularly neurological deficits after surgery. And so even if it is less invasive, there are more complications. There are some groups that are very experienced, and they actually found less complications in endoscopic surgery. But if you look at an overview of the literature that was just published recently, there is a significant number of complications with these procedures, even though in experienced hands, so that there's conflicting evidence for endoscopic treatment. And I personally think that the outcome is questionable and you have high complication rates. So this is something you have to be aware of when going for decompression of spinal stenosis. Also, consider minimal invasive surgery with the spinous devices. The biomechanics clearly show that there is a limiting factor in extension, but all the other motions in the lumbar spine are not influenced by interspinous devices. They just don't stabilize, they're not a stabilizing device. The first study, the Tukeman study, showed excellent results with a success rate of 70%. It would actually be a level of evidence 1 to 2. And but this is versus conservative care, not versus laminectomy or decompressive procedures. Very interesting, if you look at the studies out there, these are the postoperative results, the red line of the Superman study, excellent SF36 results in their X-TOP trial. And this is another study that tried to reproduce it. And as you can see, those lines are much lower than in the Superman study. So it was not, they were not able to reproduce those excellent results. And if you look at at other studies out there showing how long they work, you can clearly see that after 2 years, all devices have lost their function. So this seems to be a temporary solution, but not a long-standing solution. And if you look at the complication rates, they are quite high, and success rate of 15 to 54% in this one publication 3 years ago is just something that's nothing we should really think about, except maybe for very, very small patients. So we do have conflicting data. most promising technology for the future. If you look at minimal invasive surgery, if you use so-called minimal invasive surgery, TLIFs, percutaneous tools on one side and TLIF approach on the other side, very easily done with some experience, small approaches are possible. And if you look on the right side, how much muscle trauma you need, that's really minimal in those patients. It has been shown that the muscle and inflammation factors are significantly lower in minimal invasive surgery, that's quite clear. Complication rates are about the same in the 90-95% range. There has been a lower complication rate even for the minimal invasive procedures, and the outcome is pretty much the same. Some nice overviews that have been published recently show comparable results and also comparable complication rates, depending probably on the experience of the group that's publishing this. So the level of evidence is 2 to 3, that minimal invasive surgery, human surgery, is as good as open surgery. Another technique that has been popularized, the XLIF technique that we also use quite often in my department. And if you look at the literature, you also see that the number of reoperation and complications is quite low, and fusion rates are extremely high, with some thigh symptoms transiently after surgery due to the lateral access. So again, the level of evidence 2 to 3 that this is a successful procedure. Overall, talking about fusion surgery, I think an advantage is the cosmetic result. You do have less blood loss. Many studies have shown that. You have less postoperative pain and a faster recovery. That's quite clear. Long-term outcome seems to be pretty much the same. There is, and I also agree with this, an advantage for minimal invasive surgery in the elderly. Some studies have found dramatic differences in complication rates for the old and the obese. So these are the two main patient groups that will benefit most from the surgery. There is a problem with less control, less orientation, because you don't have a hollow space. You need more experience, you have to know your anatomy better. You usually have a high radiation exposure. Hardware seems to be a little less safe. And in my personal view, there's no really good study out there. Deformity correction is possible, but it's less successful in minimal invasive surgery. You do depend on technology, but interestingly, at least in the United States, the costs are lower because hospital stays are lower. That doesn't apply to Europe. Europe usually actually costs are higher because implant costs are higher and the patients stay in the hospital at the same time. But this is something that you have to know. Something you have to be aware of, and Nancy Epstein quoted that nicely, that we know that negative results of minimal invasive surgery are underreported in the literature. We only get results from the experts and not some true results. So I can come to my conclusions. Endoscopic disc surgery